Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/spookshow. Then go over to morbidlybeautiful.com as we are now part of the Morbidly Beautiful Podcasting Network.
Now, here is a motion picture film.
And now, ladies and gents, it's yo time!
To do the binds.
Say hello to my little friend!
Go ahead. Make my day.
Come quietly or there will be trouble.
And I'll shove that bat up your ass and turn you into a popsicle.
Inconceivable!
Welcome to the All-American Spook Show Podcast.
I'm sorry, boys. I'm afraid I can't do that. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Welcome to yet another edition of the All American Spook Show Podcast. I'm Josh, and I'm joined here with Donnie.
Hey.
And the Professor Smoke.
What's up?
And if only you could see us, like we see each other on camera here, although obviously this is for audio purposes. But Smoke has gone full the dude. he is abiding fully.
Well, you know, man, that's just like your opinion, man.
But yeah, we're here for our latest edition of Cult Corner. And we're doing one that I don't think it's... I'm going out on a limb by saying this is all of one of our favorite movies. If not ever. Definitely, like, you know, a top 50, you know, cult-type movie. However you want to phrase it. It's a favorite of all of ours. The Big Lebowski. From 1998. Yeah. We spun the wheel. We made the deal. I think we did it over on Deadline Horror News, you know, a few weeks back to decide this one because we all had our choices that we threw out there, and I believe, Donnie, this was your choice, yeah. Right? I believe it was.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
And it won the contest, so that's
good. I am thrilled.
Yeah, well, same here. I mean, like, I think the four choices that we put up that particular week, like, all of them were winners.
Yeah, I remember, let's see, it was Mallrats,
yeah.
Spaceballs,
yep.
And I forgot what you chose. But there was also The Big Lebowski. Howard the Duck
Howard
is the other
yeah,
one.
Yeah, you're right. Howard the Duck. So any one of them would have been great for this. But I'm glad that we got to The Big Lebowski. Because, correct me if I'm wrong, I think when we first started talking about doing Cult Corner, this was like one of the first ones that came up.
Yep.
Like, you know, like, well, what's an example of what we're doing here on Cult Corner? Big Lebowski was an example. You know, like something non-horror related that's a cult classic.
Mm-hmm.
And pretty much from the moment this movie came out in 1998, this thing has been an instant cult classic, you know, if you like these type of movies. I guess the first question off the top, would you consider this a stoner movie?
Yes and no. I think it's a little... thing is, like, I've watched this stone many times, many, 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 many times. But, like, there are also little wrinkles in here, you know, when I watch it, you know, completely sober, that... you know, you don't really pick up when you're just completely baked out of your mind.
You don't have to be playing along, so to speak. You don't have you don't have to be like you know, partaking in the devil's lettuce to enjoy this movie. Whereas there are those certain types of movies where you kind of have to. You know, it's kind of part and parcel of watching some particular movies. I just mean it basically kind of, I guess, in the sense of, like, what would most people consider a stoner movie is, like, Up in Smoke, Cheech and Chong, you know, that kind
of... Half-baked.
Half-baked, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Those kind of movies, it's not quite in that category of, like, straight-up stoner movie where it's, like, it's a bit more, I guess you call it, a bit more highbrow than your typical half-baked
movie. Yeah. But I will say it's stoner adjacent, at least, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
It's not far off. It's over there on the corner. But, you know, I wouldn't necessarily consider it. And the only reason I say that is because I saw, in some of my research, I saw it pop up on some, like, best stoner movie lists. And I was just like, I don't know. You know, I don't know. And it seems like we've had another movie that I'm completely blanking on that we've talked about where it was the same type of conversation where, like, they considered it somewhat of a stoner movie. And I don't remember what it was. But
I don't know. Yeah, I really don't know.
To look at the list of all the movies. We've watched so many movies now, you know, as we've done this for 3.5 years and over 100 episodes, that like some of them start to blur together. But I remember that. I want to say it was The Ginger Dead Man.
You know what? You would basically have to be fucking stoned to either watch it or to like, yeah, let me write this shit.
But is that the criteria? Like, you have to be high to watch it? You know, is that...
Maybe that's it.
Or to enjoy it?
Smoke, go ahead.
Well, there's kind of two. I guess there's two ways, right? There's movies that are stoner movies that are movies that are best watched stoned.
Yeah.
Those movies, movies might not even have any actual elements of getting stoned in them themselves. It's like, just that you would probably enjoy it more if you were under the influence of something.
Like,
you know, and then there's stoner movies like we're talking about, like Half Baked, or even like this one where there's references to or an act, or, you know, there's a lot of references to drug culture or whatever, you know. Cheech and Chong movies, as you mentioned too. So yeah, there's probably should be two categories: movies that are fun to watch and get stoned to, and movies that are just about being stoned.
Yeah, and really, this movie, the dude is the only one getting high, right? Like pretty much everyone else is, you know. although the whole cast is weird, you know, they're all weird in their own ways, but he's the only one getting high, you know, the whole movie. So I don't. I guess it's different than say comparing it to The Wizard of Oz or Pink Floyd's The Wall or something, where you need to be tripping on LSD or some shit, you know.
You know what? As soon as you mentioned and Smoke mentioned it, it was as soon as he mentioned, you know, movies that you are kind of better when you're stoned, I immediately thought of Wizard of Floyd. You know, that, like when you you play the album.
I've never done that, but I've heard so many people say that. Like I'm gonna call bullshit until I experience it myself.
Yeah, you should definitely. You know what? Maybe that's something we do for Court Corner.
That'll be episode 200 or something. Let's see.
That's the episode where we all get together at Josh's studio and eat some edibles and then watch it.
Oh my god!
No. I'm sorry. I said 200. No, I'm sorry. I meant episode 420. That's when we'll do it.
Oh,
but yeah. Anyways, we're here to talk about the Big Lebowski from 1998. So this is our second cult corner, because we did The Warriors.
Yeah.
Remember, that was back in episode 96, so it's been a minute.
96.
It's been a minute since we did cult corner, but now that we have like a definitive rotation where we're going to be doing our normal horror reviews, and in between we're going to do a Spook Show Spotlight and then Cannon Fodder, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then cult corner, and that's the rotation. Yep. Spotlight, Cannon Fodder, cult corner, and those will be slid in between our choices for the regular horror review. So just to kind of let you in on, you know, what to expect coming, you know, going forward. Now, this episode is actually the first episode of May. So that I'll go ahead and say we're going to be talking this up for the rest of the month, because we do have things kind of planned out well in advance, at least for the rest of May. And we're just now getting into the planning stages for June. So that means the latest Crafterpiece Theater poll should be up now on the socials. I only mention that because this is going to be the first taste you're going to get for what happens in June. We have kind of been flirting about it, and I'll go ahead and throw that out here now that we're fastly approaching it. Starting June 6th, which will be episode 111, we're going to begin Camp Spook Show. Now, the premise here is all the movies that we do, starting from there until episode 120, and that comes out on August 8th. So that's the window. So pretty much the entire summer, or at least most of it, they're all going to be summer camp movies. Not like movies that take place in the summer, not movies about summer, but in particular, it has to involve a summer camp. So we don't know exactly what all those movies will be yet. Those will come later in the month. We'll start announcing that.
But now, also, you probably should mention that, you know, it's not just horror summer camp movies.
No.
It's cult summer camp. It would be,
Cannon, if we can find
Cannon
one.
Cannon summer camp.
I think we got to dig around for that a little bit. But if
maybe ask Austin.
Yeah, we might have to get his input when we do the Memorial Day episode 110, is going to be our next Cannon fodder, and we can go ahead and say what that's going to be. Invasion USA, the Chuck Norris classic.
Yep.
Will be that day.
We would typically do like a spin the wheel for that, but that's just too perfect. We just decided to go ahead and name it that.
Yeah. Memorial Day is always on a Monday. Our episodes come out on Monday, so since that one's very specific, what better way to celebrate Memorial Day with cannon. Cannon fodder. Yeah, I was right.
Yep.
Then with Chuck Norris and Invasion USA. So,
perfect.
On that day, we'll ask Austin for any input on what would be a good summer camp, Camp Spook Show cannon fodder episode. Maybe we can come to some conclusion on that.
That'd be fun, man.
Yeah. So, like Donnie said, the whole summer series, it's not just going to be summer camp horror movies, because those are obvious. Like, you know, and we have a handful of those that you know we'll get to. But we're also going to do at least, I think, 2 Cult Corner episodes during... Yeah, there'll be 2 Cult Corners during the Camp Spook Show, and there'll be 1 Cannon Fodder during Camp Spook Show, and 2 Crapster Peace Theaters during Camp Spook Show, not to mention a couple of spotlights and everything else, so...
Mm-hmm.
Lots in the planning. We'll get to that later this month, you know, but before you know it, it'll be here. So we just wanted to kind of put that out on your radar. Also, another thing to put out on your radar is we just recently joined the Morbidly Beautiful Podcasting Network. So we encourage you to go over to morbidlybeautiful.com, check out everything they have to offer there. And there's tons of other, like, I guess, brother and sister podcasts now
on
their podcasting network that you should go check out. So we encourage you to do that. And, of course, you want to frequent all of our usual things. You can email us at allamericanspookshow@gmail.com. Find us on Twitter at AASpookShow, Instagram, Facebook, Slasher app, YouTube. You can find us on all those by searching for All American Spook Show. We have a Linktree link down in the show notes. Click on that. You'll see links to all these things that I just mentioned, including our Tee Public shop. We have a logoed merchandise and cool designs and everything. We need to update that with a few new things.
Yeah,
it's been a minute since we put anything new on there. And, of course, we've got patreon.com/AASpookShow, where you'll get every month bonus episodes, including Spook Show Rewind, Crapster Peace Theater, which we just talked about. Professor puts up his retro review articles. And, of course, every Tuesday we have video minisodes, including The Library of the Professor. You don't want to miss any of those. That's every Tuesday over on patreon.com/AASpookShow. So tons of stuff going on in the world of the Spook Show and the world of Morbidly Beautiful and all that. So we return back to the Big Lebowski. So I guess with that, we'll go ahead and toss the trailer.
Wait, let me explain something to you. I am not Mr. Lebowski. I'm the dude. You know, that or his dudeness or duder or, you know, El Duderino, if you're not into the whole brevity thing.
Are you employed, Mr. Lebowski?
Employed?
You like sex, Mr. Lebowski?
Is this your only ID?
You got the wrong guy. I'm the dude.
Your name's Lebowski, Lebowski.
Chuck Lebowski, the other Lebowski, the millionaire.
I received this ransom note this morning.
This is the bummer, man.
They want you to take the money and act as courier.
What do you mean, man?
What the hell is this?
My dirty undies, dude. The whites.
Let's take that hill!
Why should we settle for 20 grand when we can keep the entire million?
I know you're mixed up in all this.
Playing one side against the other in bed with everybody.
Blow them.
Huh? Fabulous stuff.
What?
Who's sitting on $1 million?
We want some money.
Sitting in the trunk of our car.
Where's my damn money?
Say, dude, where is your car?
Who's got your undies, Walter?
This is a very complicated case, Maude. You know, a lot of ins, a lot of outs.
Is this your homework, Larry?
And I would like my undies back.
A lot of strands to keep in my head, man.
Bro! Hey, careful, man. There's a beverage here, huh?
I like your style, dude.
I have no choice but to tell these bums to do whatever is necessary to recover their money from you.
They were Nazis, dude?
They were nihilists, man. They kept saying they believed in nothing. You figured, oh, here's a loser, you know, a deadbeat.
Well, aren't you?
Well, yeah.
You cannot drag this negative energy into the tournament.
Jeffrey.
Bond.
Love me.
That's my robe.
I'm throwing rocks tonight.
It don't matter to Jesus. This could be a lot more complex. I mean, it's not just, it might not be just such a simple, you know?
All right, there you go. That's the trailer for The Big Lebowski from 1998. So I guess before we get into the background here, Smoke, what's your history with this one? Did you see this back in the theater back in the day? When was one of your first times that you recall?
Now, unfortunately, I missed it in the theater. I saw it on rental on, I guess it was a bit on VHS. Hell, this was 1998. That was like the dawn of DVD pretty much. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure I rented it from, you know, video store and watched it the first time around. And actually, that's another thing, too. Whenever I see it, look at this movie, I can't think of the year it came out. And I have to look it up. And I'm like, I'm always stunned that it's in the 90s still.
Yeah.
That it's not 2000 or 2001 or 2 or, you know, I mean, it's close enough. It's 98, but.
Yeah.
But still, I keep expecting 2001 or 2 or whatever.
I guess because it's so close to the, you know, the turn of the century there, so to speak, that, like, you kind of think that way. Like, yeah, this is early 2000s, but no.
It's not old, you know, basically. None of us are particularly great with math right off the top of our head, but
24 years ago.
Yeah, 24. I mean, it definitely doesn't seem like it's that old to me.
Matter of fact, it was just 24 years ago back in March. Like, it released March 6, 1998, so it's just over 24 years old. It's crazy.
But yeah, so it was on video first time I saw it, and it's a Coen Brothers film, and I was already familiar with them, of course. And through Fargo, etc. So yeah, I liked it right away, immediately. And Jeff Bridges, I mean, I could pretty much see any movie with Jeff Bridges in it. I'm probably going to enjoy. If I don't enjoy the movie, I'm at least going to enjoy Jeff Bridges' performance.
Yeah.
And John Goodman, everybody else in this movie was great. So yeah, first time around, loved it, and seen it quite a few times since on various. You know, don't have it on VHS. This is one I don't have it on VHS. I do have it on. DVD and streaming.
I've still got my original DVD copy. For whatever reason, this is one I never updated it on Blu-ray. So, like, that's what I have here in my hand. I'm looking at it. Yeah, I think this was, like, the original DVD from, like, well, maybe not the original. This one came out in 2003. So this must have been, like, another release of it or something shortly after. Or it could be the first DVD. Who knows? Like you said, like, those early DVDs. You know,
it was the first, I think, commercial of, you know, when DVDs became really commercially available. It was either 97, 98, somewhere in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had it on VHS. And
you do?
Yeah. I watched this movie every damn week in college, just like clockwork.
And it's immensely quotable, man. I mean, you can't even watch this movie, man, without coming up with the quotes, man.
God, there are so many classic lines. So many.
Like I said, you know, off air before we started recording, I didn't realize how many random quotes that, like, I say that are from this movie, you know, and just how much this has influenced me over the last 24 years. Not until I stop and kind of like, wow, you know, like, that's some random thing I always say, or that, you know, or whatever, you know, when we're joking amongst each other and all that kind of stuff. Like, there's a lot of quotes we pull from this movie and just a lot of random things. So I guess we'll go ahead and get into the background itself. Like I said, it was released March 6th, 1998. And it was put out by Working Title Films. And it was distributed by Gramercy Pictures here in the U.S. And then internationally, it was Polygram Filmed Entertainment. And now it did actually debut January 18th of 1998 at Sundance. And then it wasn't until March 6th that it got released, you know, wide. But, I think by most marks, this one was a success. It did have for this type of movie, I'd say it's a little bit higher of a budget. It was a $15 million budget. And they made their money back and then some. It made $46.7 million in the box office. But it wouldn't surprise me if they've made tons more just on everything that has happened since then, you know, on home video sales,
license.
Like, yeah, just the license and everything. Like this thing seemed to take on a life of its own, like a lot of cult movies do.
Oh yeah.
You know, years after the fact, and this definitely follows suit. There's not many places you can go where you're probably, you know, like if you're going to some touristy place or a pop culture shop or something like that, you're not going to see something that's got the Big Lebowski or the dude. Yeah. Something to do with, you know, this movie. So like we mentioned, it was directed by the Coen brothers. Joel Coen and Ethan Coen, who would best be known, you know, from Fargo, No Country for Old Men, tons of things that they've, you know, did before and since then, obviously. Even before that, I mean, they had done Raising Arizona, Barton Fink, The Hudsucker Proxy, Fargo, like I said. Immediately after this, they did Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, The Lady Killers, No Country, like I said, No Country for Old Men, that remake of True Grit with another with Jeff Bridges. So, you know, they definitely have a lot of the same type of a similar cast in a lot of their movies, you know, like John, cause I know John Goodman's been in a few of those and hell, he was in O Brother War, though, just come to think of it, in Raising Arizona.
Yeah. Yeah, he was.
They have a lot of the same type of cast, but, this one stars Jeff Bridges as the dude. I think his actual name in the movie is Jeffrey Lebowski, right? That's where a lot of the confusion in the movie comes from.
Yep.
But they just call him the dude. It's got John Goodman as Walter Sobchak. Julianne Moore as Maude Lebowski. Steve Buscemi as Donnie. Theodore Donald Karabatsos. Donnie.
In accordance with what you think your dying wishes might well have been.
It keeps going on with the great cast. I mean, Philip Seymour Hoffman as Brant. You know, the little
God, that was
little dickhead sidekick. Yeah, I mean, he's perfect. You know, it's a small role, but Tara Reid as Bunny Lebowski. Flea, even fucking Flea from Red Hot Chili Peppers. is more, as a nihilist.
And it's supposed to be like Kraftwerk, I guess.
Yeah, you know? John Turturro as the Jesus. Jesus Quintana. Even a random appearance by Dom Herrera as Tony the Chauffeur. And a small, once again, a small cameo by Sam Elliott as the Stranger. He's kind of the narrator at the beginning and end of the movie. And a handful of other recognizable faces in this flick. It really is great casting. And the soundtrack, too, right? Smoke, like, it's perfect. Perfect.
Oh yeah,
yeah, it is.
Tracks,
yeah, perfect scene for the, you know, well, for the scenes with the dude that, you know, something he would be listening to, you know, absolutely.
The Creedence Clearwater, like the mention of Creedence, you know, throughout. But yeah, I mean, you've got Bob Dylan just on the soundtrack, Elvis Costello, Duke Ellington, Moondog, Captain Beefheart, you know, like, of course, the Eagles, the Stones, Creedence Clearwater Revival. I mean, like, the tons of good tracks in this movie. ZZ
Top. Somebody
helped
him with that. I can't remember who it was right now that helped him out with the choosing. Oh, T-Bone Burnett was who it was.
Well, there you go.
He was a music movie and helped the Coens choose songs.
So, yeah, obviously, they made all the right choices. I mean, it's a great soundtrack. And I think it works perfectly with the movie, and it really makes the movie kind of what it is. You know, like, if you had some generic soundtrack or something that they hadn't put as much thought into, I don't know if this movie quite hits the same note that it does with these tracks and everything that they selected for it. So
it's certainly a little
soundtrack that like Quentin Tarantino. I mean, that half the movie almost, well, maybe not quite half, but a very good portion of the movie is the songs that he chooses. And I think the Coens are sort of the same way, in that same boat.
Yeah, I mean, I was 17 years old when this movie came out. You know, I turned 18 a little while after that. So, like, I was right in the wheelhouse of, like, this was my kind of movie, because I was already, like, digging, like, Tarantino movies and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And you just made that connection right there that I had never really thought about too much before as far as Tarantino is concerned. It really does feel Tarantino-esque, doesn't it? Of course, some of the usual information that we go over, it was rated R. A total runtime of 1 hour and 57 minutes, but it does not feel like a 1 hour and 57 minute movie. You talk about pacing often, Donnie, in movies.
Yeah.
And this is one that is well paced, for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I'll get to that.
Yeah.
I'll get to that.
I'll go ahead and throw out the usual aggregate ratings that we throw out. On IMDb, it gets a rating of 8.1 out of 10 stars.
That's a very highly rated for
usually a lot IMDb. Of the movies, a lot of the movies that we talk about, especially on IMDb, they're usually like fives and sixes. This one's kind of 8.1 out of 788,000 ratings on IMDb.
That's definitely a beloved.
Yeah.
It
continues. Metacritic, you know, their scale goes from like, you know, 0 to 100 or whatever. It's got a 71 Metascore on there. And on Rotten Tomatoes, very impressive. 83% certified fresh on the tomato meter.
Wow. Yeah.
And the audience score is even higher over there. Over 250,000 ratings, 93%. So this isn't divisive. I think, you know, you watch this one, you love it.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's some people, you know, that this just isn't their cup of tea and they don't like it. But for the most part, I've never really heard too much negative about this movie. You know,
yeah, really. I'm not really friends with those people.
Yeah. Those are people.
Probably some people out there that don't like it the way that the dude doesn't like the Eagles.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I should mention right here, because we were talking about this off air before we started recording, there was a kind of, I wouldn't necessarily say it was a sequel. It was more of a loose spinoff called The Jesus Rolls. Now, basically, that one is, you know, John Turturro's role of Jesus Quintana. It's basically a crime comedy movie, you know, with him as the star. It's got a pretty impressive cast. I have not watched it because this movie released, like, right before, you know, all the COVID pandemic stuff started going on. So I guess maybe it kind of got swept under the rug a little bit. But it was a bomb. I mean, like, it had a budget of $4.5 million and only made $64,000. The critic reviews aren't kind to it. So I'll reserve judgment myself, obviously, like I always do, for when I see it.
Yeah, I haven't seen it.
I think we talked about none of us have seen this. So maybe that's something we can get to at one of these points. I'm just interested in watching it, if nothing else. But so there was another movie, although probably well too far after the fact. You know, they probably waited too long, you know.
Especially, last year? No, 2 years ago? 2020? Well, it came out in 2020. Right?
So basically a little over 2 years ago when it came out.
22 years later, isn't it?
Yeah, that would be 22 years. Yeah, you're right. 22 after. And it's not like that character was a huge character. Yeah, it's a memorable character.
Yeah.
But screen time max is like 3 or 4 minutes in this movie?
Yeah, something like that.
It's such a small character.
In this movie, it's a good character, but I can't see him stretched out over the course of however long that movie is, an hour and a half, an hour and 40, whatever.
Yeah. It almost feels like, you know, an SNL skit that takes off and then they make a movie out of it for some reason. Like, it just doesn't have the same shelf life when it's in a feature-length film, you know? Once again, you know, I'm sure we'll get around to it. And I'd like to check it out just because I love The Big Lebowski so much. Anything that has anything to do with that, I'm willing to check out. So there is that. So
yeah, I just haven't run across it. You know, it's, I'll, you know, if it's streaming somewhere for free, I'll check it out. But like, you know, which actually is a good question. Is it streaming anywhere?
Let me look real quick.
Yeah, somewhere when we were watching.
It is. Wait, yeah, it's streaming. I got it here. It's on Philo and Fubo TV. So I think those are like subscription services, right? But it's also on Showtime. It says it's on for free on Plex and on Crackle.
Go to Crackle.
Yeah, Plex and Crackle. It looks like you can watch it. I'm sure that's probably with ads, but still, you know.
Yeah,
you know.
Hour and 25 minutes.
Yeah, so maybe that's something we'll have to get to. And we'll talk about it here on the old show. So is there anything else you guys wanted to bring up before we start getting into it?
It was on Peacock as well.
Well, I know The Big Lebowski's on Peacock. I'm not seeing that the Jesus Rolls is on there, but it could be. I don't know. I didn't see it there.
Okay, maybe not. I remember seeing the poster. The poster or whatever you want to call it, the little blurb somewhere on some streaming service, because we watched The Big Lebowski on a streaming service too. And I didn't even know that, honestly, that there even was
another one.
Jesus Rolls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Another connected movie in the Lebowski verse.
Mm.
The Lebowski cinematic universe.
Oh gosh. I hope not.
Is there anything else you guys want to bring up before we get into it?
On the background information, I guess one thing I did find is a lot of the dude's clothes were actually Jeff Bridges' real clothes.
Yeah,
it was his own clothes, including those jelly sandals.
Yep,
which he still has.
I want to say I saw him on like Conan O'Brien or one of the late night shows where he brought those shoes and maybe like the sweater. You know, like that little cardigan sweater or whatever that was that he wore. I think he had that. And he was also talking about a story where, like, you know, the scene where it's the gutter balls dream sequence.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's floating on the bowling alley and like he spins around and he's looking up all the skirts of the, you know, that little part. Apparently that was the day that he decided to bring his family to the set for some reason.
I remember seeing that.
Was the day that they filmed that scene. So then he had a lot of explaining to do, like.
to his kids.
Yeah, yeah. Daddy, why are they pulling you down a bowling alley and you're looking up all those ladies' skirts? You know, oh, I don't know.
Well, yeah, something else I did read was this of all of, you know, the movies that John Goodman has been in, this is his favorite of the ones that he's acted in.
He's good in almost everything he does. I mean, I can't remember anything really bad that John Goodman was in that I, you know, like, oh, that sucked. You know, he's good in everything. He, even if the movie isn't the greatest, he's good in it.
Yeah.
And I have to agree. And I would have, that being said, I would have to agree. This is probably one of his best performances, you know, in a movie.
Oh, certainly so.
If it ain't his best, it's definitely one of his best, for sure.
What is it?
Hey, why it's buttercup. Popcorn, add some butter to hot popcorn. Mix it up, wrap it up, buttercup is born.
It's delicious.
So nutritious.
It's a taste delight.
It's so munchy.
Crisp and crunchy.
You'll enjoy each bite.
Eat butter crunched buttercup. Popcorn at its best.
Served in a king-size cup.
It beats all the rest.
Before we moved on to the other part, I mentioned something about the Eagles, where, you know, the scene where he doesn't like the Eagles, where he's in the cab, right? Mm-hmm. He says, please turn the Eagles off. Well, apparently that came from the other guy I mentioned, T-Bone Burnett, who was helping choose the music for the movie, suggested that the dude would not like the Eagles, mainly because T-Bone Burnett didn't like the Eagles, I guess. And again, Glenn Frey from the Eagles was, like, pissed off about this, I guess. And, like, apparently he confronted Jeff Bridges at a party one time about it. And I don't know what the outcome was. I wasn't able to find the information on what the outcome of that was, but apparently he was pissed off about the fact that the dude didn't like Eagles in the movie.
Which is an even better touch that, like, in that one sequence where they, when you see Jesus, you know, the first time you're introduced to him in the movie, and they're playing, like, that mariachi flamenco band, whatever, you know, cover of Hotel California.
Oh, yeah. That was awesome.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I didn't, you know what, that's funny. I didn't even put those two together. I mean, I knew it was cover of Hotel California, but I didn't really put that together with the later scene in the movie.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess we'll go ahead and get into it. Right. You know, usually I try to remind you off the top, but I didn't, so I'll remind you now before we get deep into it. We are a spoiler-filled podcast, so I seriously doubt anyone listening to this, especially this far, has not seen The Big Lebowski. If not, what the fuck? Like, just pause this, go watch the movie. And come back and listen to us, you know, talk about it for the next 30 or 40 minutes, because this is a good one, no question. So anyways, I'll go ahead and, now I'm going to do it a little bit differently this time around, just because, you know, like, you don't need to go deep into the, the plot summaries and synopsis here. So I'm just going to read a couple off of IMDb, just to kind of get you a feel for what this movie is about and what happens and everything. We can kind of close up the holes when we're talking about the movie here in just a second, our little round table. When the dude Lebowski is mistaken for a millionaire Lebowski, two thugs urinate on his rug to coerce him into paying a debt he knows nothing about. While attempting to gain recompense for the ruined rug from his wealthy counterpart, he accepts a one-time job with high payoff. He enlists the help of his bowling buddy, Walter, a gun-toting Jewish convert with anger issues. Deception leads to more trouble, and it soon seems that everyone from porn empire tycoons to nihilist wants something from the dude. Now, that's a synopsis from Ahmet Kozin on IMDb. So that, you know, other than, that's, you know, the details itself, that pretty much wraps it up, right? Like, that's really all you need to know about this movie.
Yeah, I mean, and then you, like, if that doesn't draw you in,
you're listening to the wrong podcast.
Just watch a trailer. I mean, the trailer will...
Just for full coverage sake, I'll read one more here, because this one's pretty good, too. There are two men named Jeffrey Lebowski. One's a lazy, pot-smoking, white Russian-drinking hippie who goes by the nickname The Dude. The other's a self-made multimillionaire war veteran who lives in a mansion with a full-time assistant due to his being handicapped. Their paths cross when the millionaire's trophy wife owes money to a known pornographer, and she's held in lieu of getting his money repaid. The thugs hired by this pornographer initially confront the dude because they were unaware he has the same name. Wanting payback for his now destroyed rug, the dude seeks out the millionaire Lebowski. What follows takes the dude and his bowling buddies Walter and Donnie on a mission full of intrigue, kidnapping, pornography, nihilist, white Russians, and more white Russians.
That is awesome.
And that synopsis is from Halo 1K over on IMDb. So, yeah, like, you know, with our little discussion here, I'm sure we'll fill in a lot of the gaps, because really this movie is just more about the moments and the quotes than it is, you know, necessarily the story itself. Because it's kind of like one of those self-contained, like, I know it takes place over multiple days, but it feels like a day in the life of kind of movie, doesn't it?
Yeah,
this, man, like, and you really don't need to know, like, you don't have to be coherent the entire time. Because you can drift in and out, sort of like Donnie does.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you can, but that helps a lot, too, that you've seen this so many times. So, you know, I would suggest, at least upon your first viewing, pay attention. But in all your subsequent viewings, because you're going to love it, then you can float in and out and pay half attention and drink a couple of White Russians, you know, maybe smoke a doob or something, and then you'll enjoy it either way. But really, the first thing that I wrote down, I think, really encapsulates everything you need to know about this, or I should say every question or comment you have about it. How cool is this fucking movie? Like, it's just the coolest fucking movie, is it not? Like, you know, just the whole vibe is just cool as shit.
Yeah, this is it's one of my all-time favorites.
I think I think Cult Corner is a perfect place for us to, you know, put this and discuss it, because obviously it's not a horror movie, and this definitely is not on Crafterpiece or any other little.
Definitely not.
And not a canon flick. So, you know, this is the perfect little spot for us to get a chance to, if nothing else, we've made ourselves an excuse to watch this and movies like The Warriors and stuff, you know, like.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what I feel Cult Corner is. It's just an excuse to watch movies we really love. Really, and you know, come on here and get to talk about them.
That aren't horror movies, but
yeah.
And that's two slam bang movies right there that we've already covered. I mean, Warriors and Big Lebowski. I mean, they don't get too much more bigger and cult than that.
No, they don't.
Certainly, so, yeah. When he's in the grocery store, the first part of the opening of the movie, he writes a check for 69 cents.
And that's what they're quick to establish, you know, with Sam Elliott's little narration there off the top, that this and that's one thing I don't think I'd ever really paid that close attention to, was the time period that this is supposed to be. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be the early 90s, right when we had first went to, like, with the Persian Gulf War or whatever. Yep. With Iraq.
George W. Bush is on, I mean, George H.W.
Bush Senior or whatever. Yeah, like, I'd never really paid attention. Like, I just figured it was kind of like present day, you know.
Yeah.
But when he said that, I was like, oh, okay, well, that makes some other things make sense, you know. Like, even like when he's having the little flashback scene or the dream Saddam. Or whatever, and Saddam Hussein is the guy giving him his bowling shoes.
that's hilarious.
There was,
oh, man.
I just never really placed it. I was just kind of like, you know, all these years when I watched it, I guess I just wasn't paying attention when he said that, and like, I was always, like, just under the impression that it was present day. But, yeah, that was pretty good. Right out the gates, when he's in this house, right, and the dudes bust in and just piss all over his rug. Oh, man, not the rug.
Not on the rug,
it really,
man,
ties the room together. Yeah, it ties the room together.
And that's really the motivation, the MacGuffin, whatever the phrasing would be in movie slang. Like, that's the whole reason for the movie, right? It's because they come in and piss on his rug, and really at the end of the day, all he wanted was somebody to replace his fucking rug, you know, like.
That's his only motivation. Yeah, through the whole movie is his only motivation. And then, of course, you know, the offer of $20,000 helps, and, you know.
Yeah.
And then that, well, then it's the says, string of events that fuck it up, especially Walter that fucks it up for him.
Yeah.
So there is a little, you know, you mentioned money. Well, a little bit on the numbers side. The dude says man 147 times in the movie. And
I just love that someone went through and counted all these instances.
And
so what you're saying is you play a drinking game, and every time the dude says Jesus. Man, you drink? No, no, you didn't do that.
No, you'd
be an alcohol poisoned dead by then.
So, and also, fuck, or any variation of fuck, was used 292 times.
What is that, about halfway through the movie when you see Sam Elliott again? And he's like, I just wish you didn't curse so much. He's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Fuck are you talking about? All right, dude, have it your way.
Oh, man. So we've talked about it, the Jesus part. Don't fuck with the Jesus.
Like, yeah.
we've personally probably got about two or three quotes just out of that one little part right there. Like,
oh, man.
it's such a classic little introduction moment to such a small ancillary character. But, yeah. Man, John Turturro just fucking knocks it out of the park, man.
He does. Yeah. It was just perfectly cast.
And it's so random. Like, it really has nothing to do with anything else in the movie.
No.
Other than just these weird cast of characters that hang out at this bowling alley.
Yeah, there are just so many classic lines. You know, you talk about, you know, you said it, man.
Yeah.
Nobody fucks with the Jesus.
Yeah. And Walter,
over the line.
And Walter just like doing, like, you know, they do the whole money handoff scene and he says, fuck it, let's go bowling. Because he does that like two or three more times, you know, like these horrible moments have just gone on. Fuck it, let's just go bowling.
Something terrible just happened or whatever, or is about to happen. Like Bunny, when he thinks that Bunny was kidnapped her and she's going to die and all this stuff. And Walter's basically done all he can do. He thinks, well, that's it. Let's fucking just go bowling.
Yeah.
Fuck it. Let's go bowling.
Yeah, that whole money handoff scene, man, he just fucks up everything, right? He throws a bag of dirty underwear out the window, and then he jumps out with an Uzi for some reason, and the Uzi goes off. And
he
wrecks the car into the tree or whatever it is right there, the pole or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh, that car awesome. Catches hell. That's like another character in the movie right there, too, right? The dude's car.
Yeah. Leads.
It gets stolen and recovered, and then it smells like a bathroom or whatever. And then he's like, "You got any leads?" He's talking to the cop, and they get leads. Yeah, we got four more detectives working on it right now.
He got us working in shifts. Yeah. And not only that, when he's smoking his joint, and he tries to flick it out the window, and it drops in his drops in his crotch, and then he drives his car right into a dumpster.
Oh, yeah. Like, and then ultimately, like, the nihilists come along and burn the car up. And he's like, fuck, man, you finally did it. You destroyed the car. I mean, it's been through hell. They killed my car. It's been through so much.
Dies.
Yeah. And it's so random, too. Like, you almost think, like, in the melee, he got shot. But no, it was just, fell over and had a heart attack.
Oh, man.
Can you get any more classic, though, than right after he dies and they go and they get him cremated and they put him in a coffee can and they go out and throw the ashes, and he just basically just the wind picks it up and throws it right into the dude's face.
He just sits there, takes it, doesn't move at all, doesn't like brush it off. He just accepts his fate. Just like, fuck it, man.
He's pretty beat down by Walter's bullshit by this point. So he's just...
Yeah.
He takes it until Walter turns around. He's like, oh, shit, dude, I'm sorry.
Yeah, he's trying to brush it off. It's in his beard.
Oh, God. Yeah, something else is, you know, aside from, you know, some of those, one of those dream sequences with Maude, you never see the dude bowl at all.
Yeah, you're right. You know, I hadn't really... Never really thought about it, but you're right. I think the only one you really ever see bowl, other than just the other random characters, will be Donnie, right?
Yeah. Because
do you even see Walter bowl?
You do.
Okay.
Because that is right after the ringer. And he said, fuck it, let's go bowling. And then he's just standing there.
Okay.
And then he bowls.
Y'all remember, I don't know if y'all ever saw the TV version of this too. Like, you know, the edited for TV, how they, you know, cut out.
No.
I don't think I ever did.
But this movie, though, is kind of like the customers, they would change stuff to make it sound like something that's not a customer.
I remember. Yeah. I think I know what you're going to say.
Yeah, it's when Walter was like busting up the Corvette outside, and he's like, this is what happens when you fuck a stranger in the ass. You know, he's like banging the car in the original version, right? But in the made for TV version, they changed it to, this is what happens when you find a stranger in the Alps.
I remember that shit. I had forgotten about that.
It's absurd than what he was saying anyway. So it's even more funny, which I've seen some movies like that. They used to do that more so in the mid-80s, late-80s.
In the 90s, yeah.
That reminds me of... They did that also for Usual Suspects. instead of "Give me the keys, you fucking cocksucker," said "Give me the keys, you fairy godmother."
That was pretty fun about the if you had to watch these movies on regular TV edited versions, I'd rather watch something like that than where they just cut it out or bleat or silence or whatever, or
you find because that almost makes it Alps.
That's pretty good.
That's awesome. I had forgotten about that, man. Good call. I am the walrus.
Shut the fuck up, Donnie. That's awesome too. How like everything Donnie says, Walter's like, "Shut the fuck up, Donnie." And then he finally makes like one good point. I can't even remember exactly what it was. He makes a good point, and then
He was coming back. He was coming back. He said, "They just posted the results for the next round robin." I said, "Donnie, shut the fuck. When do we play?"
There was one other thing he gave him, but it was right after he told him to shut the fuck. It was when they were in the theater watching the play, when they were like doing their little, when they thought they were like being followed or something. They're like doing their little get together. And then Donnie mentioned something about the In-N-Out burger. Oh, yeah. Maybe we can go by the In-N-Out burger later. He's like, "Shut the fuck up, Donnie." Then he goes on and on to the dude about whatever. And then he goes, "Yes, by the In-N-Out burger. We'll get something later or whatever." We'll get after his little burgers. Spiel, you know, he gave him, the only two times he gave him a time of day or whatever.
Yeah, we'll get us good burgers, get us some Josh. Give us some burgers, have some laughs. Yeah, it'll be good.
Oh man,
tons of quotes, especially with you and I, Donnie. We've always joked because the dude's name is Donnie, so it's perfect. We do the in and out, shut the fuck up, Donnie.
Yeah,
you know?
it's
24 it years. 24 years strong. Same joke. Yeah. The one question I didn't write down that I just thought about was, what was the deal with the kid? You know, because you reminded me about it when he goes out there and smashes the car, and then the guy comes out, you busted up my car. I just bought it last week. And
I kill your fucking car.
And he just beats the shit out of the dude's car. Yet another thing that happens to the dude's car that I failed to mention. But what was the deal with the kid? Like, why was the kid's homework stuck in the seat? And, like, I don't remember if they ever made, like, a true connection there, did they?
No. No,
I think he's just a red herring. Like somehow his homework was in there, right? Or was it?
Yeah, like how the fuck did that happen?
Yeah, I don't know. Like they were parked outside in the in the handicap spot, and then they thought the car was towed, but it was stolen.
The kid's dad wasn't an iron lung, so maybe the handicap spot has something to do with that. I don't know. You're trying to tie up an end, like, because it seemed like they tied up all the loose ends except for like where the kid fit in, like,
you know, kind of like this is way off, kind of off topic, but if you're in an iron lung, I don't think you can go anywhere.
Yeah, probably.
I think
not,
you just stay in that iron lung.
Yeah, because if you did, you can't breathe and you die. I think it's pretty much breathing for you, right? So
yeah,
I don't know. That was the only weird time, and it was a funny scene and everything, and maybe that's really all that matters, you know, but like as far as tying up all the loose ends at the end, they pretty much brought it all home except for that little part. Like, what the hell did that have to do with anything? I guess that, I mean, unless there was something else you guys wanted to mention, that's pretty much a wrap on. I mean, like, we've talked quite a bit about it, and
here's a little speculation. If you want to talk about the kid one more time, or you know, like say that maybe the kid did steal the car, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the briefcase was in the car. The briefcase had what, phone book in it, right, or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Maybe the kid took the million out and put the phone book in there, and then the family has the $1 million.
Yeah, maybe.
Mm.
Maybe that's the part where, like, you know, if you had a time to sit down and talk with the Coen brothers or whatever, you know, about like this movie, that'd be the one thing, like, well, what do you think happened? You know, like, that's the one little thing they left out for you to kind of figure out yourself, kind of thing, you know?
But now that part I just talked about, I can't remember where they did the million, where the phone book fit into. Was that during somebody's flashback showing them putting the phone book in there? Was it the Big Lebowski? Did they show him in a flashback? Pieces of phone book in the briefcase?
It was a little later on in the movie, though.
I think it was towards the end.
When they were, it was more of like an expose type.
Yeah, I just couldn't remember where. I remember them showing somebody in some scene putting the phone in there instead of $1 million or whatever. But I just couldn't remember.
Yeah.
Context. So my little fake theory of the kid probably wouldn't fit anyway. The context probably would have been blown out by the Tennessee or the memory of putting it in there. probably in a scene where it didn't involve that, you know, showing them actually doing it or whatever.
Well, the only thing you know is that the kids' homework got in there somehow. So that means they either shot something that they cut out, or it just was never meant to go anywhere. It was just some random hobo had it for some reason and left it in that car. And then, you know, maybe it had nothing to do with anything. Who knows?
Maybe stole the car for a joyride or whatever it was he did with it and never found the briefcase, or or found the briefcase and saw it's full of phone books and didn't care.
Maybe it was Jackie Treehorn. I just wanted to say his name because we haven't said Jackie Treehorn.
Yeah. Hey, dude. Thanks for coming. I'm Jackie Treehorn. That's been my bowling name a couple of times.
And to reference Over the Top, I usually use Bull Hurley or Lincoln Hawk.
Yeah.
When we put in the
I've
bowling
used Lincoln
name.
Hawk a couple of times. Lincoln Hawk. God, man.
So, yeah, awesome. We're on a pretty good run here with the Big Lebowski this week and Phantasm last week, and we did Over the Top before that. Even Deathgasm, man, we've had some really good ones here lately. And two weeks before that, Night of the Living Dead. So we've been able to mark off some pretty good ones here on the list, and this is yet just another one. So I guess that'll naturally lead us into our star rating. So, Donnie, since we did spin the wheel, but this technically was your choice, why don't you go first?
This is a super easy one for me. This is one of my personal all-time favorite movies ever. For me, all of this movie is perfect, all of it. So that leads right into my 5-star rating.
Wow. Another first, well, not a first, but other than the Reanimator, Smoke-rated Reanimator 5 stars. Now, granted, this is Cult Corner, so it's kind of the little side thing, but... Yeah, only the not counting the cannonballs, you know, of the Cannon Fodder series. This is the first time we've had another 5-star rating, so that is big. Mm. And of course, Will's not here today, so we can't get his rating. We'll get it next time. But Smoke, what do you got to say?
Oh man, this movie sucks. I'm gonna give it 0.5 star.
What?
I've just been glowing just to impress you guys, but really, fuck this movie.
No, it's What more can be said, really, about the Big Lebowski that we didn't even talk about? I'm sure there's plenty more trivia and stuff, but what more glowing things could be said about the Big Lebowski that we didn't already? It's a great film. If you like cult movies, if you like comedy, if you like, hell, if you even like, you could almost call this movie a neo-noir for a certain amount of it. It's got some nods to some Raymond Chandler type private detective stuff and whatnot going on. And even though it doesn't have the look of a neo-noir film, but it's got that private eye stuff. It's got Los Angeles as a sort of a character in the movie too, you know, and just all the characters that, as we mentioned, it's got those sort of a soundtrack going for it. Act galore. I mean, total cast is amazing. I think I'm going to go with it. I certainly can't go any lower than a 4.5 on it. So I'm going with a 4.5.
I can't say that I disagree with anything you guys have said, and I can't even wholeheartedly disagree with giving it a 5. But for me, that's rare air. I gotta hold on to 5 for personal reasons, for like, you know, just fucking epicness, perfect, like a personal top 10 movie. And although this is possibly a fringe top 10 personal favorite for me, it's not top 10. So I'm gonna go 4.5 like Smoke. But good lord. You know, a 5 and 2 4.5s, man. Like, I'm going to go out on a limb and say Will's probably not going to be too far off from these. We'll see what he says. But, yeah, you can't go wrong with this movie, man. It's such an awesome movie. I can't tell you how many times I've seen it. I enjoy it every time. I dare say it even gets better with age. You know, like, it definitely doesn't get worse.
Definitely not.
It's not dated at all. You know, even though it's a movie from 1998 that is supposed to be about the early 90s, it feels like something that could have been made last week. It holds up. I mean, what more can you say, man? It's really a great flick, and I'm glad we were able to do it on here and have a chance to just talk about it, because I said, if nothing else, it's a good excuse to watch it again, because I just love this movie. So 4.5 for me, and we'll get the consensus when we can get Will's. But of course, on Cult Corner, we don't do kill counts and gore score and everything, because that just doesn't make sense. But we still do the cult connection. So, Donnie?
Donnie, where's the cult connections? Come out and play!
Well,
Oh man!
Before you get into the cult connection, let me just say before you do that, I'm hilarious.
I'm just gonna let these things.
Fuck. Just gonna let that play out.
I find it hilarious that people who have never seen the Warriors before in their life that watch the show are like, "What in the hell?
Yeah,
what is that?"
Now, come on. Even if you haven't seen the Warriors, you probably know that scene, right? Like the little
You should know that scene. I know there's some people out there that won't know it, but you should know it.
I'm sure there's some people. Yeah, you're right. There's, you know.
Yeah. So, typically, if you're just joining us, typically what we do with the cult connections, we also do it with some of our other movies, our other series. We connect the current movie episode by any cast or crew connections to past Spook Show episodes. So for this episode, The Big Lebowski, we do have one cast connection. Christian Clemenson, who played the eager note-taking cop. I guess that would be the best way to describe him. He was also in Malignant, which we covered in, I don't recall the specific episode.
That was episode 91.
Episode 91, okay, yeah. So he was in Malignant, and on the crew side, one of the special effects crew members, J.D. Street, was in Smoke's favorite, The Curse of La Llorona. and then there was also...
That was episode 56, by the way.
Oh, it was.
If for some reason you wanted to go listen to that.
Yeah, that's why 56. I didn't, elaborate.
You should watch that instead of watching the movie.
I'll give you that. Yeah, you should definitely listen to that episode. just skip the movie.
Just skip the movie.
Yeah.
And then there was also several stunt crew members that were also on Critters. There was just one. That's a different,
Now that one's going back. We did Critters. That was all the way back in episode 11. So you got to go deep into the archives for that one.
Yeah.
I didn't think I'd hear a connection to Big Lebowski to Critters, but once again, Donnie, you never cease to amaze.
That's what we do, man.
All right. Well, I guess that's pretty much it for The Big Lebowski. I mean, really, there's not much more we can say. I mean, it was basically just the last hour or so of just us spewing love for this movie. So, and it deserves every bit of that and then some. This is a
certainly
great movie. So, don't forget, next week we've got Smoke's Choice, where we're going to be talking about Session 9. That is one that I have not watched, so I'm looking forward to that.
Mm.
And then after that, episode 108 will be the next Spook Show Spotlight. We haven't quite got down exactly what the theme will be for that one yet, but I'm sure it'll be another cool topic that we'll have to talk about, and that will lead us straight into episode 109 the week after that, where we dip back into the Hellraiser series with Hellraiser 3. So, big plans for throughout the month of May, and then, of course, Memorial Day, we've got Invasion USA, our next cannon fodder, leading us into the big summer event, Camp Spook Show. So, lots of cool stuff on tap. You don't want to miss a thing over on Patreon, of course, patreon.com/AASpookShow. Find us on all the regular socials. You can't miss the Spook Show. And, of course, go check out MorbidlyBeautiful.com and all the other brother and sister podcasts over on the Morbidly Beautiful Podcasting Network. So for Will, who was on assignment, couldn't be with us today, Donnie, Professor Smoke, I'm Josh. We are from the All-American Spook Show Horror Podcast, and we will talk to you next week.
Please replace the speaker on its rack when you're ready to leave. Failure to do so will damage both the speaker and your car. We'll be grateful, and so will the patrons who follow you.